Hi, I'm Matt Weed from Luminar Technologies. Not all LiDAR is created equal, and so what we're going to do today is talk a little bit about all the decisions architecturally that Luminar has made, that others make in the marketplace, and where some of those decisions may have led others astray, whereas Luminar continues to see really strong traction with our architectural choices in the LiDAR community. The goal is to understand the environment, and that's why Luminar is working with our customers and our partners to build these ecosystem solutions in a way that does just that. They understand the environment. They allow these vehicles to operate in those environments. And as we'll see today, important architectural decisions drive how well that understanding can be extracted. So as you see here, there's four major building blocks of any LiDAR sensor. There's the receiver, which is where the data pipeline starts. There's your emitter, or a laser, which goes out and samples the world. And there is your field coverage, or a commonly scanning technology, which allows you to sense from various parts in a 3D environment around the vehicle. And then, of course, there's the processing chain that pulls all of that fundamental LiDAR information together, packages it into a three-dimensional point cloud, and then builds through these perception layers to extract understanding from the environment. What you see to the right is the result of Luminar's decisions architecturally in each of these areas, summing up to give us a leadership position. What you see charted here is the max resolution and radiometric performance of dark objects over range, charted against each other. And you see a number of common architectures charted in there, and you see a relationship with these, where to achieve long range, you have to sacrifice resolution, or to achieve high resolution, you have to sacrifice range. And up there alone in the upper right is Luminar, differentiated in performance in the landscape because of these architectural decisions that we're going to go through today. So now, the first major area that we're going to talk about is the idea of arrays versus scanned pixels. Arrays are like a camera, where you have a whole bunch of detector pixels, which are either imaging the full two-dimensional scene or one-dimensional part of the scene and singularly scanning in one dimension. These technologies end up relying on a lot of components. You end up having to have a single laser, single receiver for each pixel in the scene. That ends up having high component costs, really high cost floor, ends up being a result of these architectures. And you end up with challenges in the reliability of the data because of the uncontrolled lighting in the environment, lighting up all of these different detectors. Being able to sort all that out in post-processing is quite difficult, as well as it takes a big hit to the reliability of these kinds of sensors. On the right, you see an example of Luminar's architecture. It's much more simplified. We have a single laser, single receiver set pair that will then scan throughout the whole three-dimensional scene. This allows us to have very few components, particularly the expensive components like lasers and receivers, and allow a configurable way to see the scene in the environment. Here are some examples of what kind of problems are common in these kinds of array-based LiDAR sensors. On the left, you see two examples of what looks like weird artifacts, and these are indeed artifacts. What's common is that when you have very bright targets like retroreflectors, traffic signs, license plates, even parts of taillights in cars, these can all flare out and cause all kinds of strange, what we call crosstalk, in these images, which reduces the system's ability to rely on this data to understand what's happening there, because you have all these strange, unpredictable behaviors of objects. On the bottom, you see the same thing in a two-dimensional flash, a full flash, unscanned system, where you see very large, what we call blooming on that stop sign, which can serve to obscure some of the important objects that could be behind that stop sign. For example, pedestrians looking to step out into that crosswalk. On the right, you see an example of Luminar LiDAR data where you have a high dynamic range grayscale within the point cloud itself. That's not a camera image, it's a LiDAR image. And you see that there's these stop signs attached to this black fence. That black fence is detected, as are the stop signs, which are highly reflective. And we still retain the geometrical shape of those stop signs without artifacts obscuring the scene around it. Another way that these kind of arrayed systems can be problematic is in weather. Similar to how light coming back from a stop sign can illuminate more of that scene than you intend. A snowflake scattering light can do the same thing. As you see in a famous example on the left, Waymo talking about how difficult it is to operate in snow just natively with these sensors because you get all these artifacts. Now, with Luminar's technology, because we're isolated and measuring only single parts of the field of view at any given time, we can ignore all that light that's happening in the rest of the scene and only focus on what we're trying to measure. So we measure snowflakes where there are snowflakes, but that's it. And we can see through that to see the road plane, to see the objects, the pedestrians in the scene, in a way that is very, very reliable. What it also allows us to do, moving away from arrays, is to have software configurability. And what we mean by that is software can adjust our way that we see the world to pick up on regions of interest that are of more interest than others. As you can imagine, driving in the road, particularly in highway, understanding what's happening up in the trees may not be as much of use as it is exactly on the road plane at hundreds of meters away. And so we can focus our attention with a region of interest on a portion of the field which can move frame to frame. And all of this is because we've made this architectural decision to not use arrays and use a two-dimensional scanned system. So the next architecture point is specifically in the area of scanning, in two-dimensional scanning, and we're looking at MEMS, micro-scanning versus larger type of mirrors, like what Luminar uses. So what you see here in the architecture diagrams is a lot of components, kind of similar to the array problem. So even though these are fundamentally a similar architecture where we have a detector and a laser and a scanner, these scanners have fundamentally limited field of view. And so if you have to capture a large part of the field of view, which is necessary to drive a car, you end up needing multiple of these systems to be able to capture that whole field of view. Further, because that aperture is so micro, we're talking millimeters up to a centimeter in size for these MEMS mirrors, you have to send more energy out to make the same long-range measurements, and generally have multiple receivers to be able to sort out the energy that comes back. And so when you build a system, when this all comes together, even though we're just talking about a method of scanning, it ripples into the whole system. You need higher energy lasers, you need arrays of detectors, you need the ability to account for the disruption in these devices due to shock and vibration in post-processing to put together a reliable point cloud. Where in Luminar's system, we use slightly larger mirrors, not leveraging silicon actuators, which are prone to this distortion, and that allows us to be much more stable against the environmental conditions of automotive LiDAR. So when talking about MEMS, it's important to know what we're talking about. A lot of people think MEMS is solid state, including a lot of MEMS manufacturers calling their LiDAR solid state LiDAR. In reality, as you see in this example here, these are not solid state devices. They move, and they move quite a lot for the scale that they live on. The other thing that's important here is that these mirrors aren't really micro. MEMS stands for micro electromechanical systems, but that micro is really important for the success of MEMS devices more broadly. And what you see here is the size of these mirrors make these devices actually not a very good MEMS device. These end up being quite fragile. And so it's good to understand really what people are talking about when they talk about MEMS. And as you can see, there's a lot of challenges to overcome with these technologies that are certainly just not solved yet and may never be for the automotive environment. Pulling a lot of these together, we look at an example here through Luminar LiDAR, and I'm going to explore a point cloud that will show you how this stuff comes together in a way that gives you reliable, high-fidelity data. So bringing a lot of these elements together into an example of what Luminar can do, we show an example point cloud from Luminar sensor from a single vantage point. And we start out looking at a building. There's some objects in the foreground that we'll understand in a moment, but what we see here is what's commonly looked at when you look at LiDAR maps. You see a building with fairly large scale, lots of measurements, but what's special here with Luminar LiDAR is this is how we see this building at 150 to 200 meters away. As I start scrolling back through this point cloud, closer to where the sensor is actually stationed, you got to see what's in the foreground. You see a marina, you see boats, you see masts and guy wires associated with these boats at 100 meters and beyond. You see a boat here in the foreground where you can understand the curvature of that bow. You can see as we continue to pull back, you see some ducks floating in the water in that marina. And then eventually we get all the way back to the pier where the vehicle is stationed. And we get very tactical information about what's happening right in front of the sensor. We see that there's cobblestone. We see that there is a very distinct curb. And we see the blockage devices there that are meant to make sure you stay on the road. So being able to have all of this information really requires stable scanning, requires an architecture that has isolation to interference. And putting that together is really what is important and what Luminar is really set apart from the rest of the landscape because of. All right, so next up on our architectural discussion here moves away from field coverage and into how we make our range measurements. The first one here is the idea of continuous wave, commonly referred to as FMCW, versus pulsed LiDAR. I'll explain a little bit more what these mean, but to start off with, at a high level, architecturally, the result of these sort of continuous wave LiDAR detection devices results in, again, very high component count. Fundamentally, these devices end up trading measurement time, so measurement rate, for sensitivity and quality of measurement. And so when you have a specific requirement for the sensor, which is, again, driven by the perception requirements to understand what's going on in the environment, if your sensor technology fundamentally measures more slowly, you need more of them to measure the same set of scene KPIs. And so what we see here is being able to cover portions of the field of view in a single sensor to be able to come together to measure the same kinds of things that Luminar's architecture can do from, again, that same standard architecture. Looking at that in a little bit more numbers, we kind of get this sense where the single pulse event is very fast. Our ability to know where those pixels are coming from happens almost immediately from getting that light back. So once we send light out, we wait for it to hit a target and come back, we immediately know where that target was. With these continuous wave systems, you have to send a modulation, which is a much longer duration to start with. It has to go, hit a target, come back, start being collected, and commonly you need more than one modulation to be able to extract an accurate and high fidelity measurement. And this is for each individual pixel in the scene. And so this time is a multiplier across every measurement you're trying to make. And so as you see here, you end up with a deficit of measurements made, which needs to equate to how many transceivers you need to be able to hit the requirement at the top here. Shown in a little bit more pictorial fashion, what you see on the top is a Luminar example compared to the best we could do to show an apples to apples with an FMCW example. What you see here is what we can put together using these two technologies in roughly half a second, which is a not very practical example, but it shows a lot of the tricks that get shown when we look at FMCW type techniques. They tend to slow the frame rate down, they tend to use multiple sensors to try to cover the fact that the measurements are sparse. And that's exactly what you see here. You know, Luminar isn't exactly shown at the top, zooming in, showing that range, that depth of understanding, that resolution, the amount of measurements we can capture. Compared to on the bottom, you see an example of a much smaller field of view, but the same amount of time, and it's still very, very sparse. And so this is an example showing the kind of trade-offs that drove Luminar to not pursuing these architectures. So a very similar trade-off, but a very different technology base, is the idea of doing single photon detection. So Luminar uses a linear detection scheme, which allows us to build these beautiful grayscale images that I've been showing today. And that's because we know how much energy comes back from each pixel. So as similar to a camera, if we know how much light comes back from each pixel, we can build a grayscale or a reflectance point cloud. With single photon detection, these detectors don't know how much light came back until they can measure many of those events and build a histogram to understand how much energy may have come back over time. And so as a result, you see these devices all go to arrays, thinking back to the beginning of my talk, and the problems that come along with those, and the fact that you have to have a large area emitter as well. These single photon detections sound great in theory, but because they can't tell the difference between one and a million or a billion photons, they have to stack to be able to build the same kind of point clouds that the requirements demand. Again, in pictorial fashion, or I guess looking at curves and things here, we see that with the pulse time of flight, you make that one measurement once, and you move on to the next pixel in the point cloud. The single photons, you have to make many measurements of each individual target, build that histogram to understand what is the object. That ultimately leaves you with a need for a lot of lasers and receivers, and this system ends up getting very cumbersome, expensive, and prone to all the array failure modes that we discussed earlier. As an example here, again, trying to show apples to apples in time, which is really what's important here, you show a point cloud over a second, which, again, not very practical, but it shows how much information we can extract from the environment on the same time scales that we talk about in a system that's using a single photon-based scheme. On the bottom, you also see an example from this group of the data pipeline necessary to extract the actual point cloud from all of this noise of a well-lit environment. And you can imagine how much processing is required there and why this is so slow, because of the raw data you start with being fundamentally less actionable. So pulling all of this together, really our goal here is to be able to understand the environment, like I said in the beginning. To do that, we need to measure lots of points in the scene. They need to have good, strong reliability in angle and in range, so you can build a three-dimensional understanding of the scene. And we need to have it in a way that we can then process that data through what's called perception to extract understanding. As an example, here's a point cloud of a highway scene. You can kind of get a sense of what's happening, but as soon as we start adding color overlay, you really understand what's happening. We can see that the roadway is well defined with red classified points. We can see that the lane lines are marked out to and visible out to 150 meters. We can see that there are objects on that roadway assigned to their lanes and detectable out to 250 and beyond, depending on the object. What we have here is what we call a semantic point cloud. It's really what's that first layer after the raw point cloud that allows that first understanding of what's happening in the scene. And it's really a result of all the architectural decisions that we've made that led us to this kind of point cloud, which is what's driving all these programs forward. So to kind of sum up a lot of the architectural decisions that we've gone through today, we look at the ranging method. We didn't talk about wavelength much today, but it's certainly an important point that is well talked about. The longer the wavelength, the more eye safe the technology is. And so Luminar goes with 1550 nanometers to leverage a lot of the existing ecosystem from telecommunications. FMCW and single photon detection, as I mentioned, end up trading their sensitivity and quality of measurement for time. And for driving, for mobility, this is a tactical sensing application, and that time means safety. It's just not an okay trade to make for this marketplace. Then, to cover the field and understand the three-dimensional environment, there's the difference between arrays and scanning. With arrays, you end up with limits to eye safety, as well as a lot of the artifacts that come along with pixel-to-pixel interference. Looking at scanning technologies like MEMS, which we talked about, and on-chip devices, truly solid-state devices like optical phased arrays, these technologies end up being not good uses of the technologies available for mobility. They're simply not very efficient. They end up having trade-offs and drawbacks with regards to the automotive environment, and they're simply just not mature to be able to be deployed in the foreseeable future in this marketplace. And so Luminar takes our 1550 nanometer technology, brings it together with advances in laser and detector technologies, scan that throughout the scene in a robust and dynamic way to be able to capture the environment necessary to understand the road scene. All of this hasn't come easy. We've been at this for a very long time. And what's interesting is a look at the ecosystem and how we actually deliver these technologies. Traditionally, startups and small companies focus in the early development cycle. They look at fundamental research, component development, a lot of the ecosystem that exists there of startups. And then, commonly, tier ones focus on industrialization of these technologies when they become mature. What's interesting with LiDAR is that the demand for this technology has kind of outpaced the maturity of the fundamental technologies. And so only companies like Luminar who can pull across this development life cycle are able to really be successful. Luminar didn't very early go and partner with an industrialized development partner like a tier one because we knew the market wasn't ready, the technology wasn't ready. We needed to prove it to ourselves, we needed to prove it to our customers and build the early industrialization routes that the tier ones aren't set up to build in the first place. You see some examples here across that ecosystem of some who have reached partways into some of these different stages of industrialization with mixed levels of success. But what we found and why we haven't thrown our architecture over the wall to a tier one early is that you need to have a capable and well-partnered ecosystem there to be able to receive that technology, especially when it's early. And so a lot of the technologies that have gone too early are basically met with undeveloped industrialization partners in their core technology. And that's in a way that Luminar has really taken all these architectural decisions, built the ecosystem to deliver it internally, and then are finding partners to scale that ecosystem into the world so that we can actually push the future of mobility. So again, all this comes together to be able to understand the environment. Here's some examples of what we can do in an environment to pull understanding from the scene, understand the road, understand obstacles, track objects, and that all comes down to our ability to do all of these different LiDAR tasks in a way that is cohesive and reliable. So with that, thank you very much for your attention today. I hope you've learned a little bit of something about LiDAR technology. My name is Matt Weed with Luminar Technologies, and I hope you've enjoyed what we had to say today and urge you to visit our website, luminartech.com, to learn more. Thank you.